Hello, my dear students, friends. So this is Purabi ma'am. Probably this is your third economics class. So welcome you all to the economics class. We have no option left but to meet you all like this. But so must go on. So we have to continue our studies. So in this regard, I just like to tell you one thing that if you come to know if any of your friends are not able to reach to us with this digital platform, maybe due to lack of device, maybe due to lack of network, so please share with them this video, whatever way possible, or we will definitely try to reach each and every one, and tell them they can also share their problem with us. We are always there to help them out at this hour of crisis. So with this note, I would like to start today's class of economics. So I'm going to take unit 3, that is of producer behavior and supply. So let us start our class. So my dear students, friends, we are going to start our class now. Let me share my screen with you all. Before starting the class, I'm going to take microeconomics unit 3. So before starting the class, I just like to suggest you some books of microeconomics which I am also following. These books are basically introductory microeconomics for class 12 by Sandeep Garg. As you can see, the first book, and the second book is introductory microeconomics by Dr. Deepasri. Both books are good, but I suggest that the book by Dr. Deepasri is a wee bit good, because it has all the detailed concept of microeconomics that will help us in future also to understand the various aspects of economics. So otherwise, there are a number of books available in the market. You can go to any book, but if you one thing that if you go to these books, you see these books are only for microeconomics. So you have another portion that is macroeconomics, so you have to buy one more book for macroeconomics. So if you don't want to invest in two books, so you can go to any book which club together the micro economics and macroeconomics. So that will also do. But one thing that you have to be careful, that while buying the books, you just must see the syllabus, that book must have covered the syllabus. I know that you all know the syllabus, so don't forget to check the syllabus in the book. So after that you can buy. I know every book has given its syllabus, but still you should check before you are buying. Okay, so unit 3, producer behavior and supply. As you can see in the screen, that we have 5 different topics or subtopics, we can say, of producer behavior and supply. First one is production function, then supply, cost, revenue, and producer's equilibrium. So we will discuss all these topics one by one. So today we are going to take the first topic, production function. So before discussing directly the production function, we must know some of the basic concept of producer behavior that will help us to understand the production function. So here I have mentioned about the production factors of production. So firstly, we can say, what is product? Product is an item, or it can be a service. For example, you can take the mobile phone you are using. So that particular device is what? Is the product. And the network you are using, some are using BSNL, some are using Idea, some are using Vodafone, whatever network you are using, what is that? It is nothing but the service. So both the network and the device are nothing but the product. So product can be a service or it can be a item. Okay, the next, what is production? Production, simply we can say, it is when we convert raw materials into a finished good. The process is called production. So when we convert raw materials into finished good, definitely we create a new item, a new product, which should have the utility. So technical definition of production is, production is creation of utility. So when we combine all the factors and we put them together and we create a new item, that is That particular process is called production. Okay, so now in this process of production, we have different factors of production that we put together. So what are these factors of production? We have basically four broad categories of factors of production: land, labor, capital, and organization. So these all factors are again classified as fixed factor and variable factor. So what is fixed factor? Fixed factors, the term itself said that it is fixed. So fixed in what sense? Fixed in the sense that if we want, it does not change with the change in the output. So to change the fixed factor, it takes a longer period of time. For example, we have given here machinery, equipment, land, building. So I'm not saying that you cannot change, you can change, but changing takes a long period of time. So in that way, it is considered as fixed factor. So immediately you cannot change. So it does not change with the change in the output. Then the variable factor are the factor inputs that can vary with the change in the output. So whenever we want to produce even one unit more, this variable factor changes. For example, raw materials, power supply. If we want to work more, we need more power supply. If we want to produce even one more unit, we need to supply more raw materials. So labor, fuel, these are the examples of variable factor which varies with the change in the output. Then next you can see in the screen that we have given the concept of time, which is associated with the production, and this concept of time element is introduced by the Alfred Marcel. So what he said, that he said that there are four different concept of time: very short period, which is also known as market period. So what happens in market period or very short period? That in this period all factors of productions are fixed, so we cannot change any factors of production. So definitely we cannot change the total output, or cost of production also remain same. Then comes short run. Short run is a period where we have some fixed factor and some variable factor. For example, we can talk about agricultural activities. Okay, so in agriculture or cultivation, what happens if we consider land as a fixed and labor as a variable factor? Immediately, if we want to increase the production, then we can increase by increasing the variable factor, that is labor. So land, we cannot immediately buy one new plot of land, it takes time. So for a particular period of time, we can consider that land is fixed. So that time period is called short run, where some factors are fixed and some are variable. Then comes long run. In the long run, all factors are variable because it is long run. We can change the entire factors of production, and we can change the entire plant of production. We can set up a new plant. So everything can be changed. So that is why it is called long run. And the last concept of time element mentioned by Alfred Marcel is a very long run, which is also known as secular period. So what is the difference between very long run and long run? In very long run also we can change all the factors, but along with that some of the factors which are not under control of the firm, for example technology, government policy, change in population, so these factors can also change. That is called very long run. So these factors are not under control of the firm. So but in our discussion we are going to consider only the short run and long run. So the very short period and very long period we are not going to discuss. So in our discussion we will use only these two time periods, short run and long run. So now comes to our main topic, production function. What is production function? A production function is a transformation of physical input into output. So production function is a technical relation between input and output. So input means what? All the factors, land, labor, capital, whatever we have discussed just now. So all the factors can be considered as input. And by combining all the factors together in some technical form, we can produce the output or the service. That technical relation or functional relationship between input and output, or the way we process input into output is called production function. So we can mathematically also express the production function as I have written here, you can see the screen. Q is a function of x1, x2, x3, ...xk. So here Q is nothing but the output. F is the functional relationship between Q and the axis, that means input and output. And all this x1, x2, xk are nothing but the inputs. So, but here for our analysis purpose, we are going to consider only two factors, capital and labor. So, all the factors we cannot take. So, to discuss further, we consider only two factors, labor and capital. So, we have considered Q is a function of L and K. The total output is a function of labor and capital. So now, types of production function. Talking about the types of production function, you see here I have mentioned short run production function and long run production function. So we have already discussed what is short run and what is long run. We have also discussed production function. Okay, and you can see that there are two factors, fixed factor and variable factor. So short run, what happens? Short run is a period where we have fixed factor. And short run is a period where we have some factor which are variable. So short run production function is a production function of two factors, variable factor and fixed factor. So here I have written CQ is a function of L and K this. So where L is a variable factor and K this is a fixed factor. So short-term production function is a function of both the labor and capital, but capital is a fixed factor here and labor is a variable factor. Then you see in the long run is a period where there is only one factor, that is variable factor. So there is no fixed factor, and that is why Q is a function of both labor and capital, and here both labor and capital are variable. That means what? In the short run, if we want to increase output, we can increase only by increasing the variable factor, that is labor. But in the long run, we can increase output by increasing both the factors, labor and capital. That is what the short run production function and long run production function means. Now, production function, short run production function, long run production function, then these are the mathematical equation. Short run production function gives us a theory called law of variable proportion, and long run production function is also associated with a theory or law called law of returns to scale. So these two law explains how our total output changes with the change in the factors of production. So in the short run, definitely only one factor, that means labor. When labor changes, keeps on changing, how Q behaves or how Q changes. Then in the long run, when both labor and capital changes, how Q changes. So that is explained by law of returns to scale. And law of variable proportion explains when only the variable factor changes, in what proportion the total output changes. That is what these two theories are there. But before explaining the theories in detail, I'd like to mention some of the basic concept of product. So there are three basic concept of product, such as total product or total physical product, average product or average physical product, marginal product or marginal physical product. So what are these products? Total product, it means the total volume of goods and services produced by a firm during a given period of time. For example, if we say that there are three laborers and they produce 30 units of eggs, so thus we can say here that total product is 30. So mathematically or equation, total product, we can get it from average product as well as from marginal product. So when we multiply average product by the number of factor or labor factor employed, we get a total product. Or when we add the marginal product together, then also we can calculate the total product. So now average product, what is average product? So average product refers to the product per unit of factor labor. Now, here what happens? Average product per unit of factor means, see our example, there are three laborers, they produce 30 units of X. So now, how many units are produced by each labor? So definitely 10, 10, 10. So average product is calculated, but it is total product divided by the number of factors or labor employed. So 30 divided by 3 is 10. So 10 is our average product. Now comes the marginal product. That marginal product refers to the addition made to the total product. So whenever we use the term marginal in economics, we always use it in the sense of addition. Marginal cost is additional cost. Marginal product is additional product. That means addition made to the total product due to change in the additional unit of factor. So here, same example, we can mention that there are three laborers, they produce 30 units of X. Okay, so now if we increase one more labor and the total production, we see that it becomes 38. So that means what is the addition made to the 30? Definitely it is 8. So 8 is what? 8 is the addition made to the total, and it is called marginal product. So marginal product is calculated by this method. MP is equal to delta Q by delta L, that is change of Q by change of L. There is one more mathematical equation with the help of which we can calculate marginal product. That marginal product is marginal product of n factor minus marginal product is the total product of n factor minus total product of n minus 1 factor. So I have given here one table with the help of which we can easily understand this three concept of product: total product, average product, marginal product. We can see we have taken three labor as a variable factor, 1, 2, 3. So when we produce, when one labor is used, he can produce 10 units of product. That is, for the first unit of labor, total product is 10, and average product is also 10. 10 divided by 1 is 10. So addition, what is addition? Or you can write 10 or you can leave it blank, that doesn't make any difference. But when we employ the second labor, we can see the total product increases from 10 to 22. So what is average product here? Average product we can calculate just by dividing the total product by the number of labor employed. So 22 divided by 2 is equal to 11. So that is the product per unit of the labor. So each labor is producing 11 units. So in this case, what is marginal product? You can see marginal product, that earlier what was the total product? 10. So what is the new product? 22. So when we made the addition, means when we deduct 10 from 22, we get 12. So this 12 is the addition made to the total product. Then lastly, same, when it is 30, our average product is 10. When it is marginal product, when total product is 30, our marginal product is 12. That is, the addition made to the total product is 12. So from 22 it becomes 30. So we added 12 more units of output. So this is the basic concept of production and production function. So to analyze the theories of production function, as I said, a law of variable proportion and law of returns to scale, we must know this concept. So after this concept only, we can find out the relationship between the total product, average product, marginal product, how it moves, and when there is a changes in the labor or the variable factor, how the total product changes. So that will also be explained with the help of the theory of law of variable proportion. So in our next video, we are going to explain both the law of variable proportion and law of returns to scale, that is short run production function and long run production function, with definitely diagram and tables. And I hope this basic concept of production and product will help you to understand the production function. So if you have any doubt regarding this concepts or regarding this class or video, we have created a WhatsApp group. I have given the link down there, so you can copy the link and you can join us through this link, and you can chat with us. You can ask your queries, questions, whatever, clear your doubts. So we are always there to help you out. So we'll meet you again till our next video. Stay safe, stay home. Thank you.